It is a beautiful day at Wembley Stadium as fans of Cheltenham and Crewe gather for the final game of the Football League season. At stake, a place in League One next season. So Crewe's proud record of producing young talent just continues. 9 of the starting lineup today are academy graduates, and 2 of them have been revealing some of the secrets of the success.
Definitely one of the best players we've produced at this club.
Dean Ashton, he was just different class, he was unbelievable. Roll through them all, you know, they've all had good careers.
It inspires you on it, you know, it gives you that belief that, you know, other people have done it before you and gone on to do bigger and better things and represent England and play at the highest level. So, you know, when you come round and, you know, you only have to look at the walls around the place and hopefully where the next generation now to go on to bigger and better things.
What makes Crewe so good at bringing young players through?
Obviously, it's the coaching staff. They do so much towards helping the lads. They all have faith in you, behind you, all the way.
What sort of things do they do with their players to try and make them better footballers?
I think everything's just done with the ball, you know, as an early age, you know. You don't ever do running, you know, it's all these guys running, you know, if you do running, it'd be with the ball, it's all technique work. Everyone on our team, our squad are comfortable on the ball because from an early age they've been used to playing with it.
Oh, he scored! It's Max Clayton! The youngster has surely sent Crewe Alexandra to the final!
Is it the biggest day in your life?
Definitely, most definitely, it's my biggest achievements in football so far. You know, as a League Two footballer at the minute, that's the pinnacle of your career, isn't it? To play at Wembley, you know. People who play in the Premiership for the last 10 years don't get the opportunity to play at Wembley.
What do you look forward to most?
Just stepping out and just seeing people there, your fans, family, friends, and just getting all the support you can, hopefully. And
I think the lads just relish it, to be honest with you, because all the lads are so young. You know, as you said, they haven't experienced it before, and they're just thriving on the opportunity. Everyone's looking forward to that. We know we can get the right results.
Neil, amazing looking at those pictures hanging up there, including your good self. I might add, but it just reminds you of some of the players they produced down the years. How do they keep on doing it?
I think Dario was key in all of that. What he did with me was, you know, I got released at Man City, my chin was on the floor. He saw something in me, and what he does, he develops you as a young player and makes you appreciate the game, understand it tactically. He was way ahead of his time in the early 90s. He was incorporating stuff that Ajax were doing with their academies long before the influx of the foreign players in England. And it's just been this sort of philosophy that the club has had. I mean, you see the training ground now, that wasn't there when I was there. So they've redeveloped the ground, they've put all the money back into the club, and it's just kept the club going and successfully for so long.
And Peter and Nick Powell, have they produced another gem?
Absolutely. A tremendously balanced individual, tremendously balanced player as well. I think Neil touches on it, you know, with Dario, mentally he gets you attuned, you know, you live right and everything like that. And it comes across in his play. He's a real mature player. You look at these types of goals that he scores, it's all right having that ability, but it's to have the vision and awareness and the mental strength to try something like that. You know, that was his right foot, this is his left foot. The goal doesn't change, he makes intelligent runs as well. And he never panics, he's a nice little dink over the keeper. He's got everything in his armoury. And we say in a situation like this, mental strength is so important because it takes you to the next level.
So has he got a maturity beyond his years?
Absolutely, without a shadow of doubt. And he's got a footballing brain. He's a really intelligent player. He makes clever runs. He never marks himself. He always comes up because he's not the most physically developed, Simon. So if he gets involved in a wrestling match, there's only going to be one winner. But he occupies people drops into that space. He's like a typical number 10 who can pick other people out as well, but a very, very good player. When I went to see him, there was Manchester United scouts, Chelsea scouts and Arsenal scouts there, so that tells you something about the kid.
And there might be a few here once again today. Let's get a word now with both managers, Mark Yates and first, I should say Steve Davis. First, Mark Yates alongside Patrick Davison.
Mark, for many of your players, this will be one of the biggest games of their careers, if not the biggest. Looking at them in the changing room and in your build-up to today, do they look ready?
Yeah, they certainly do. They've got a steely coolness in their eyes, I can see. You know, we've trusted each other all season. We've worked extremely hard for today, and I'm confident that my players will stand up to the test and handle the game.
Well, we came down on the Friday morning and brought them here to have a look at the place. and obviously, you know, get the photographs and the looking around and the wow factor out of the way. And then we had a nice relaxing time down at the hotel. We trained at Arsenal, which is fantastic, and the players have thoroughly enjoyed the build-up. So they're nice and relaxed, probably a bit more relaxed than I am.
How are you feeling?
I'm fine, yeah, I'm all right, yeah. I'm enjoying the challenge of what's coming up, so yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
What would your final message to your players be?
Just do what they've done all season. They've been absolutely fantastic this season. It's been about work rate and quality and the collective. It's not about one individual, and we don't want to get into that today. We don't want one person, you know, running the show and trying to do anything different to what they've done all season. They've been about the big group, the whole squad, and so far they've achieved the playoffs, and if they perform again, we have give ourselves a great chance.
To go and enjoy it and to play with that freedom that they have done, which has got us there, and you know, if they do that, they've got a good chance of getting through.
Thanks, Steve. Good luck.
Cheers.
But Grant, as someone who's played in playoff finals, how difficult is it to do that?
Yeah, it is. It's really, really difficult. You know, obviously, the nerves, when the nerves kicks in for the players when they walk out, I think it's really important to get a touch on the ball and make it a good one, first of all, for the players. And, you know, hopefully they can do that and settle into the game right and quickly.
I think for many of these players, first time they'll be playing here at Wembley, is part of the key to what happens today, who settles first.
Absolutely. Spot on. Wembley can inspire you, it can also spook you, you know, and I think whoever handles the occasion, if Crewe can settle into their passing game, it's a hot day out there, they may be able to wear Cheltenham down over the course of the 90 minutes or the 120 minutes, but you're spot on. Whoever settles best has got a, you know, really good chance of winning the game.
I wonder if it'll be a day to celebrate for Dario Gradi, who is Crewe through and through, a key part of their success down the years. I mean, Peter, yesterday it seemed very much between Huddersfield and Sheffield United, a game that neither side dared to lose. What should we expect today on another very hot day?
Very hot day, but Neil's touching on it there, the patient passing game of Crewe against the dynamism and the pace and the power of Cheltenham. It's a direct contrast, and it is who can wrestle possession and dictate the game and force and get their most important players on the ball earlier in the game, you know, because the first goal is so important. It's not to just help the team settle, but get the fans with you as well, and, you know, make use of the negativity from the other fans who look, some of them well-dressed and some not dressed at all.
There's some burned people out there already. If it's like yesterday, it could be very burned come the end. Neil, will the managers here be giving a final message, or is talking done?
I think the talking's done. Just little bullet points, but, you know, one game can sort out your season, and it's not an easy place to be for a manager at the minute, and you've got to put their trust in the players. It'll be hard to get instructions on the pitch with the atmosphere and the noise, and you got to trust them and let them go.
So, after 48 league games and 9 months of football, it all comes down to this. Cheltenham and Crewe, one win away from promotion to League One, but who will prevail in the heat of Wembley this afternoon? Let's find out in the company of our commentators, Andy Hinchcliffe and first Bill Leslie.
Well, Cheltenham were rewarded after they went for a positive lineup in their semi-finals against Torquay with two up front. And for this big day out at Wembley, they stick with the same. But it's Jeff Goulding, who's only started one game since March, who comes in to partner Ben Burgess, who played here for Blackpool in the Championship playoff final 2 years ago. Kaid Mohammed and Jermaine McGlashan shone in the semis. They'll provide pace down the flanks. Luke Garbutt, on loan from Everton, missed both legs of the semi-finals with a hamstring problem, but he returns today. Steve Davis reckons his boys became men in the second half at Southend last time out. Well, they have a chance today to etch their names in club folklore. May well be the last time Crewe fans get to see Nick Powell in their colours. He's hotly tipped to be on his way to the big time after this match. He'll again partner AJ Leach-Smith up front. Luke Murphy has been in a bit of a race to be fit for this, but he has been declared fit after recovering from a hamstring injury, so he makes up one of 9 academy graduates in this lineup. Jimmy Spencer started both legs of the semi for Cheltenham, but he finds himself back among the substitutes this afternoon. 17-year-old Max Clayton scored the goal at Southend to bring Crewe here to Wembley. He came off the bench to do that, and he's back on the bench today. So the final domestic issue to be resolved. It's between the sides that finished 6th and 7th in Empower League 2. Cheltenham, the comparative Johnny-come-latelys, just their 13th season as a league club. Crewe with their rich traditions. First a Football League club back in 1892. A and out into a sweltering afternoon at Wembley Stadium. The two teams come bidding to end their season on a high. It's been billed, Andy, in some ways as a clash of styles, a clash of ideologies, but Cheltenham will come here and look to play a bit of football too, won't they?
Well, with what we saw in the semi-finals, they'll certainly try and do that. I'm pleased that Mark Yates has gone for a 4-4-2 formation as well with those two strikers, so he's going to take the game to Crewe. But this Crewe side, the young side, on a fantastic run of form, there'll be no fear from them whatsoever. We know they can play really attractive football. Can they handle, though, the big occasion? That's what this is all about.
Both clubs have played at Wembley before, but this is their first time at the new Wembley, and there is a first today for this League Two playoff final. The first time that the Wembley roof has been retracted. You see there above the head of the chairman of the Football League, Greg Clark, who leads the presentation committee. Jason Clark, director of finance at Empower, the Football League sponsors, and Sue Gurney, a hospice nurse from the Football League's chosen charity, Help the Hospices. It's a side, as we said, that include nine players who came through the academy system, most of them together, four players under 21. He said, Steve Davis, that they became men. This is a big test, isn't it?
Well, it is a big test, but it's important those players have grown up together at Crewe, and it's so important you stick together on occasions like this when the nerves are really starting to kick in. You need the trust of the manager. Those young players have really got to trust each other.
Crewe came with that extraordinary late run. Unbeaten now in 18 games against the Cheltenham side, who've approached these playoffs from a different direction. At the start of March, they looked in good shape for automatic promotion, but their form fell away dramatically in that month. They've recovered well, won their last four games, and as the manager told us moments ago, they feel in fine fettle to take the next step. Before we get underway, we'll have the national anthem, which will be sung here by Bella Fiore. These are two clubs that came down to this level three seasons ago. One of them will be returning to the third tier. We'll find out who when we come back.
Stadium for the final act of this Football League season. It's the League Two playoff final. Cheltenham and Crewe for a place in League One next season. Your commentators, Andy Hinchcliffe and Bill Leslie.
Well, it's been a slightly staggered finish to the football season, hasn't it? But this afternoon, that final issue will be settled. One place left in League One. Swindon, Shrewsbury and Crawley already there. Will it be Crewe or will it be Cheltenham who will join them there? Two traditional centre-halves captaining the side. Alan Bennett, the Irishman for Cheltenham Town, and David Artell for Crewe Alexandra. Playing through the pain, he is still not fully recovered from a broken bone in his foot. Yates, who brought Kidderminster here for an FA Trophy final against Stevenage Borough. That was the first competitive match at the new Wembley back in 2007. Looking to become the first man to manage and play in a competitive playoff final success. Steve Davis, playoff winner with Nantwich Town back in 2008. But both managers with plenty in common, both from a similar area of the Midlands, just outside Birmingham. Played for the same Sunday League side, played for the clubs they now manage, and stand on the brink
they return to the third tier. Craig Paulson, our referee here. Fascinating clash of clubs and in some way of ideologies here. We know about Crewe's emphasis on youth. 18 of their 26 man first team squad homegrown tells you all you need to know about that. Cheltenham have been more about unearthing unpolished gems from elsewhere, leaning on the loan market, juggling their resources to form a winning team. And here's McGlashan. He certainly turned it on for the cameras in those two semi-finals against Torquay, scoring in both legs. Crewe immediately looking to get on the front foot. You'd expect them to enjoy the wide open expanses of this perfect Wembley playing surface. They look to have settled straight into their stride, don't they? Byron Moore provides pace, as is the manager's son, Harry Davis.
I'm sure the managers will say to the players, look, it's not easy, but we have to get over the novelty of playing at Wembley. We've got to stick to the game plan to get the job done here. And you can see straight away Crewe, what kind of side they are. They get on the ball and they're going to give Mark Yates' team lots of problems. Steve Davis will encourage him to go out, get that ball and knock it around. You see in the opening minute, that's exactly what they've done.
Five wins in their last six games for Cheltenham. It shows that they do have deep character within the squad. There are many who've not been able to overcome the disappointment of missing out on automatic promotion, and that has served itself as a bit of a hangover in the playoffs. I was asked Sheffield United about that yesterday. Tootle looks for the return from Nick Powell, the youngest player out there at the age of 18 and probably the most discussed player as well.
Well, the Cheltenham defence have a lot of thinking to do in how they deal with Nick Powell, because he won't play throughout the game as a true centre-forward alongside Leach Smith. He will drop into the spaces as he did there in between the lines of the midfield and back four, look to get on the ball and get Crewe moving forward. He's a creative player as well as a goal scorer.
Football League Apprentice of the Year, Player of the Year and Young Player of the Year at Bresty Road. His billing is a lofty one. Davis. Mohamed getting on the ball, rolling it rather than firing it wide.
Oh, he's a long way out, he's on his right foot as well, but Mohamed is a real danger. Normally going on the outside of fullbacks, this time he comes and joins in, comes infield. He might as well have a pop in the early stages of Wembley final. You just never know what can happen, but he's stronger on his left-hand side.
Record of enjoying himself in the playoffs. Khaled Mohamed was one of the stars of the show for AFC Wimbledon in their conference playoff success last season. Adam Dugdale clipped this one forward for Crewe. A touch from Moore. Powell is operating wide on the right on that occasion.
Well, Cheltenham playing with the two strikers with Golding and Burgess. The service into them needs to be a lot better. They need to get the ball into the chest of their two strikers. They can retain possession, the whole side can move up the field, because at times Crewe will dominate possession and force Cheltenham back. So when the Cheltenham side get it, the service to their strikers has to be good.
Powell. Martel. Moore. Davis. Certainly no lack of confidence from this comparatively young Crewe side in these opening stages. Knocking it about with aplomb. Here's Powell. McGlashan tigerishly biting back at him. Powell finding space. This is Summerfield. Powell. And that'll be a free kick.
Yeah, Cheltenham just giving the ball away a little cheaply. It's just encouraging Crewe to keep coming at them. Powell, a few occasions now, is just dropping off, picking the ball up. It's causing Cheltenham real problems.
It's going to be Ashley Westwood to fire this one in. Martell is up, Bugdell at the far post. Came off the head of the skipper.
There's certainly a bit of grappling in there. It's not the easiest ball to defend, but I'm sure there's a bit of grappling. Artel, does he get hold of one of the Cheltenham defenders and force him over? He does. You can see they're just leaning on the back of the defender. It is a foul. The referee, right call.
Well, in many clubs, 31-year-old David Artel might not feel that old, but I bet there are times at Crewe when he does feel a little out of his depth in that respect. Mohammed. Struggling to hold on to possession early on, Cheltenham, when we heard Mark Yates talk about how that was part of their game plan.
There's a key battle in central midfield with Westwood and Murphy up against Summerfield and Packen. That's generally where the tempo of games are dictated. At the moment, it's Westwood and Murphy who are getting on the ball, picking out Nick Powell, so that's why we see more of Crewe in the opening 5 minutes or so.
Elliott. In a high boot there against Ben Burgess. And he certainly provides them with a target man, 6'4", plus the quiff of Ben Burgess. Scored a trademark header, didn't he, in that first leg home win against Torquay, that proved to be so important in the end. Here's Leach Smith. He's tended to be eclipsed a little bit in terms of headlines, AJ Leach-Smith, because of the form of Nick Powell, but he has had a wonderful season as well. Heavy touch from Mohammed. Harry Davis. Murphy, looking for Byron Moore.
Oh, it's so important for Cheltenham, especially Luke Summerfield. He's the destroyer, really, in central midfield. He's got to get closer to Luke Murphy because he's just going to spray balls around this Wembley service. Big pitch here. If Murphy gets on the ball, he can pick out Byron Moore. He's got Matt Tootle down the left-hand side as well. They can really stretch the game.
Marlon Pack. And he's given it away. Powell trying to take advantage. Summerfield snapping at his heels. Elliott's had a clear. Here comes Ashley Westwood, trying to manoeuvre himself into a shooting position. Taken off the toes of Luke Murphy. Cheltenham will now endeavour just to hold on to it for a little bit, which they're unable to do. Moore has it back. Powell. Releasing to Leach Smith. And repay the favour to Powell. And they can't keep squandering possession like this, Cheltenham, or they will be made to pay. Leach Smith, little slip from Powell. Burgess waited for it. Pack. He's lost out to Powell, who now has a little pocket of space. And this is where he enjoys picking it up. This is Murphy. Onto that left.
It was a fantastic start to the game from Crewe. Cheltenham just can't get out of their own half. Crewe really patient, keeping that ball moving. I mentioned about the midfielders, the central midfielders. They can play as far up the park as they want to do because they're dominating possession. That's why Murphy's on this ball on the edge of the Cheltenham penalty area. And this needs to change. If Cheltenham's to get a foothold in the game, they need to get hold of the ball. They need to keep it much, much better.
It's not an afternoon to do a lot of chasing, is it?
Powell again collecting. Leach Smith on the move ahead of him. Leach Smith far wide this time, but they are carving through Cheltenham at will at the moment. Crewe Alexandra.
It's not for the first time. Leach Smith playing as the lone striker. Powell dropping in the hole, picks up the ball. He's looking for his strike partner. It's a decent run. There's no real conviction though in the shot on his left foot. Doesn't really trust himself. Maybe he should have kept possession and tried to pull that ball back rather than shoot.
He's enjoying himself today. He's enjoying his best run in the side. This is his 14th start in a row. Goals have come with that, two in his last three. Elliot misjudging it. Luke Garbutt, the on-loan Everton fullback.
True in all levels of football, if you dominate possession like that, you really need to grab a goal. You need to score when you're playing well. The Crewe are playing really well. Doesn't matter whether it's at Gresty Road or at Wembley, you need to take a chance. And a terrific start to the game.
Elliot pressing from the front, not giving the Cheltenham centre halves any time on the ball, and Paul again closes in on Elliot. Be absolutely delighted with the start they've made on most levels. There's McGlashan. John Batty thought about getting forward, a run beyond, but here is the Portuguese fullback. He's threaded through McGlashan. Stung the palms of the goalkeeper. And now Crewe can break through Baron Moore. Powell. By Bennett, the Cheltenham captain. Leach Smith. Westwood. Moore. Powell. Burgess able to turn it round the corner. There's open ground ahead of McGlashan here. Just wants the early ball. McGlashan did well to pick out Goulding in the end. It looked like he'd run into a bit of a cul-de-sac.
Yeah, last opportunity when McGlashan in behind the Crewe defence. He could have picked out Jeff Goulding on the penalty spot. We'll get a chance to have a look at that, I'm sure, in a second. But a really open game.
Leach Smith. Moore. Launched away by Scott Brown, who was one of the heroes of that second leg. Torquay, when Torquay turned the pressure on, he had the answers and good saves. And he's really come into his own. Jack Butland is now in the full England squad, of course, after the withdrawal of John Ruddy. Had a spell on loan in League Two with Cheltenham. And since he was recalled by Birmingham, Scott Brown's returned to the side. He stepped up to the plate. The way these opening 13 minutes have gone, you sense it may be an afternoon for him to do the same. Garbutt. Burgess. Goulding. Trying to pick out McGlashan. McGlashan just clipping Kelvin Mellor. Well, he had that opening earlier, didn't he, Andy?
We saw it in the semi-final. A couple of goals that he scored running in behind left backs. Exactly what he does here. He could have picked out Goulding, actually. On the penalty spot, he's looking for Burgess, which is a much more difficult ball. It's a really clever run, he stays onside, just doesn't really make his mind up, should be pulling that ball back away from the goalkeeper.
Oh,
during the meetings between these two clubs in the regular season. It was Crewe that came out on top in both. But narrow margins, just 1-0 in both games. There's Mella. Lovely turn, and what a goal that is! That is why he is so talked about. Top class from Nick Powell.
Well, Nick Powell, 18 years old. We're talking about maybe moving to the Premier League. You can see why, because the finish is absolutely emphatic. But the turn on the edge of the penalty area is quite brilliant as well. He looks so simple, but he makes it look so, so easy. And that's why the top clubs are looking at this young man. What a stunning goal. You've seen it in the opening stages, just dropping off and picking the ball up. But this turn here, as he just turns away from two, three defenders, no second thoughts, just puts his left foot through the ball. And Scott Brown, absolutely no chance of stopping this. This is a quite stunning opening goal.
Nick Powell living up to the billing, giving Crewe Alexandra the lead at Wembley. Well, you can't say it hasn't been coming.
Been fully deserved, but again, you've got to underline, 18 years old, to have the presence of mind and the ability, the confidence to take on a shot like that. Young players would maybe take a 2-3 touches just to make sure they've got it under control. Powell doesn't do that, gets it out of his feet, knows exactly where the goal is and slots it right in the top corner. Incredible.
Not identical, but you're reminded a little bit of that Thierry Henry goal against Manchester United. The flick and the drive. One big similarity between them. Oozing with quality, both of them.
Well, it's instinctive, that's what it is. I just mentioned both players. I certainly wouldn't have taken anything on like that. Most strikers would think twice about turning and shooting from there, but for a young man to do that, quite incredible.
Cheltenham must respond, and they very nearly do. Goulding rattling the crossbar. The flag is up.
Oh, we're talking about stunning strikes, and Jeff Goulding, doesn't he strike this one brilliantly? Steve Phillips maybe doesn't expect it, it's such a long way out. And it crashes off the bar, there's so many players then converging on the ball, it's very hard to pick out what actually happened. It's a good response from Cheltenham, though, from going behind. This is an awful long way out. Must be, what, 35 yards. Catches it brilliantly, catches the keeper out. He's back on his feet, Steve Phillips, but he's not sure. There's three, four players converge on that ball. Burgess is probably hindered. He wants to get to this, but a wonderful strike from Jeff Goulding. Just needs it to dip a little bit more. Does the keeper maybe get a fingertip on that? And they just about get away with it, but Ben Burgess is flying at that ball. It seems his own player actually gets in his way, and he can't get a header on it.
Well, the only game that he's started in recent months was on the final day when players were rested, regular first-team players were rested. He hasn't scored since January. Mark Yates said he threw him in today, Jeff Goulding. He just had a feeling that he might be able to produce on the big stage. He very nearly did, with a response of some measure.
You can see what happens when strikers drop off and pick the ball up. We've seen it with Nick Powell with the opening goal, and Goulding did the same thing, not up alongside Burgess. He drops in the hole to pick the ball up. Great position here, he picks it up, and it's the confidence and the ability to take this on. He's so, so unlucky. And they just can't force the follow-up in.
Almost need to remind you, we're watching the fourth tier of English football here. One stunning goal and one stunning attempt inside the first 19 minutes. Holding it up, Summerfield's lost out. Westwood. Here comes Powell again. Yeah. Goulding. Here's Tuchel. Rick Murphy. Davis. Moore. Leach Smith. And have the free kick through.
Both sides, of course, matching up 4-4-2, but it can be a little bit predictable if you just play with your two strikers, as Cheltenham are doing, lumping it forward towards both of them. Crewe can get themselves set, challenge for the first header and pick the second balls up. As we saw with Goulding and with Powell, you just drop off, you just give defenders more of a problem. This is just a stunning goal, but look at his first touch, the finish is brilliant. His first touch away from two or three defenders, and then doesn't even have to look at the goal, he knows exactly what he wants to do. Puts his foot through it in the top corner, a quite stunning goal from a fantastic young player.
Mohamed. Garbutt. Marlon Pack. John Batty. He's back in his preferred right-back position after filling in at left in both semi-finals. No change from Mella, from McGlashan. And Martel can sweep it clear for Crewe. Sarfield loses out. Here comes Tuchel. Leach Smith on the move. Powell. Hanging it up for Byron Moore, who looks for Tuchel, who's coming off this left flank. Westwood to keep it alive. Tuchel. Cheltenham can breathe again. Goulding. Dunked out. Stealing in ahead of Kaid Mohamed.
It seems at times that Cheltenham are really struggling to pass the ball on their surface. It seems to be a little bit stickier for them than it is for Crewe, so it's a confidence thing, they're just not putting enough on the ball, but in the warm-ups, that's what they're there for, to get a feel of the surface. It just seems Cheltenham really struggling just to pass the ball properly.
Well, it was certainly an interesting dilemma for Mark Yates for much of the season. He's alternated between 4-4-2 and 4-5-1 or 4-3-3 formation, whichever way you want to look at it. Started 4-4-2 in both legs of the semi-finals. They were excellent, particularly in the first leg. Nearly undone with that formation down at Torquay in the second leg. And opted to be bold here. If you look at this first quarter of the contest here, you would certainly say Crewe and their passing, and Steve Davis' philosophy, has been carried through a little better than Cheltenham have been able to come to the party.
The obvious problem for Mark Yates is Nick Powell. That's been underlined with the goal that he's just scored, but this, the position that he's playing is the major problem in terms of the team formation. And I mentioned maybe changing it. They've got Russell Penn on the bench. They brought him on in the second half against Torquay, and that made a big difference. And he's just trying to stop the influence of Powell, because if this carries on and Crewe continue to dominate possession, you can see them getting a second goal, and it's a long way back for Cheltenham.
Well, it was November when he moved back upstairs, Dario Gradi. 18th in the table they were, Steve Davis came in. Didn't change too much, just brought a different slant on the Dario Gradi philosophy, which has been in place at the club since 1983. And the success story has gathered apace. Only three games before the end of the season that they came into the top seven, into the playoff places. And here they are, the lowest ranked side in the playoffs, leading in the playoff final. Summerfield. Well, you mentioned the problem of dealing with Nick Powell in the formation that they have out there at the moment. Whose job is it? Summerfield?
What's going to have to happen is one of the strikers has to drop back into midfield, and Pack or Summerfield, probably Summerfield, you're right, has to really man-to-man marking when Crewe have possession, because He's picking up the spaces. There's players with nothing to do in Cheltenham shirts, so someone has to pick him up, and it's one of the two central midfielders that has to do that job.
You don't want a centre-half coming out, being drawn out of position, do you?
Well, that's the last thing they're going to do. Experienced centre-halves, Alan Bennett, Steve Elliott, they're not going to step out there because they know the problems then will be behind them. So it's up to the central midfielders ahead of them. One of them just drop in. Maybe Goulding drop off Burgess as well into midfield.
Little touch on Goulding's in, but he's offside.
And that's what I talked about, being a little bit predictable. I'm sure that Goulding is offside, but the crew back four, as Burgess goes up for this ball, they know they can keep the line. They can see Goulding running in behind them. You see, he just steps up there, it's a nice line. He's caught a couple of yards offside, and crew can do that because they know that Burgess is looking for that flick on.
Started the season at Aldershot, was a January acquisition, really financed his fee that they paid Aldershot by the good cup run that they had. Cheltenham, remember, beat him in the end, but setting up a third round meeting against Tottenham. John Batty. Pack. Elliot. Bennett hanging it up. McGlashan. John Batty, good whip on that cross. Hamid Mohamed couldn't get his head to it. But Cheltenham seem to have settled. Garbutt. Burgess Mohamed!
Well, this is what Cheltenham need to do, is deliver that ball into Ben Burgess from higher up the field. It gives him a chance of maybe heading it goalward, or maybe heading it into the danger zone. That's exactly what he does here for Mohamed. He's on his right foot once again, he's on the half turn, he's under pressure. It's a difficult strike to control and keep on target.
Mohamed. One pack decided not to shoot. He's fed Garbutt. And Cheltenham are starting to get some significant joy with their more direct approach.
Well, they have to get McGlashan and Mohamed into the game in wide areas, delivering dangerous crosses in. I see four Cheltenham players in the box, waiting for that ball in from Luke Garbutt. That's what they've got to do. Be brave, get on the ball, get it wide.
Play to their strengths, which they are starting to do. We've already seen what crews are. One throw from Marlon Pack. Come on! That will be Cheltenham's first corner of the game. I'm sure this is an area that Mark Yates has inked in to try to exploit. Pack delivers.
There's complaints from the Cheltenham players that there wasn't a shove in there. Craig Pawson disagrees. I'm not a big fan of ball swung away from goal. They're a big side, Cheltenham, really should be whipping that in. Both centre-halves are up from the back as well. Is there a foul there? There's an awful lot going on in there. The referee very harsh to a free kick possibly against Burgess.
Well, it's the first half an hour, Andy, isn't it, that's belied the conditions. It's, if anything, as hot, if not hotter, than yesterday. But these two sides have both adopted very positive approaches.
It's all about intent. Yesterday's game, Huddersfield, Sheffield United seemed keen on not losing the game. Both these sides seemed keen on winning it. Cheltenham made a bit of a rocky start. Crewe were certainly in the ascendancy, but Cheltenham come back into the game. They're starting to get their wide players involved, and They're desperate to get an equaliser before half-time. Summerfield. Mohammed. This is John Batty. Glashan makes another one of those runs in behind. Call comes from the keeper. Experienced Steve Phillips. Kelvin Mather, the left-back for Crewe, has to have watched the DVDs of the semi-finals. And Glashan kept doing this, coming short and then running in behind him. He's got him once already. That time he sees what the winger's looking to do and just steps across him. Field. He's found a way through to McGlashan. Summerfield. Pack. Well, in the first 20 minutes, every loose ball was being picked up by Crewe. Now it's a much more level playing field. McGlashan won't make up the ground there, though.
It's amazing how the balance of the game can really switch in the space of 10 minutes or so. Crewe started well, got the opening goal. It's Cheltenham starting to dominate the ball and force Crewe back.
If you missed him after the first 10, 15 minutes, it was 67% in Crewe's favour. Well, it's an afternoon for refreshment, isn't it? Summer has arrived. 3.5, the pitch side temperature. The roof open for a football match here at Wembley for the first time. Thinking behind that, we were told, was that it would allow a little more breeze. Oh, very nearly allowed an opening there for Baron Moore, who wasn't giving up the ghost, and Garbutt will breathe a sigh of relief.
Fantastic goalkeeping from Scott Brown, because it's a really poor pass in the end. It's fairly comfortable up to this point. Just takes it easy here. It's a poor header. Aaron Moore very nearly gets in there. Keeper does well.
Burgess again winning in the air. Goulding!
Well, he's under some pressure from Adam Dugdale, but he'll be really disappointed. Jeff Goulding, that he's not at least hit the target here. This is the combination they're looking for, Cheltenham, with the front two. Great first touch. Sits up nicely. He's got to get over the top of that. Got to get his knee over the ball. You've got to hit the target from this position. It's really poor. Slashes at it. It's wild and it's way over the bar.
Well, half an hour played. Time to take on a little bit of fluid. Well, credit to the players for producing what they have done so far. A thoroughly entertaining 33 minutes of League Two football.
This just underlines how hot it is down there on the field. It's hard when you're sat at home watching this. It looks a fantastic day, and it is, but the heat down there pitch side is incredible. It's good to see that the referees are being sensible as well and giving the players a chance just to take on some fluids.
Taking some on themselves as well. I spoke to both managers before the game, both very keen, having watched yesterday, not to have the extra half an hour and penalty kicks that the League One final required to separate Sheffield United and Huddersfield. And the way their sides have gone at it would suggest they're looking to finish it off in the regulation 90. But this is the moment, the standout moment of the match so far.
It's just a fabulous goal again, however you look at it, from whatever angle you look at it, it just gets better and better. The young player, so much promise. Just added maybe a couple of million to his price tag.
And if you believe what you read, that'll take it up to six. In recent weeks, rumours have followed Nick Powell around as to his future. And he is on the ball again. Tuchel picks up the bat, and advantage will be played by the referee. Can Tuchel take it?
Oh, Cheltenham fans aren't happy. They feel that John Batty there was just wrestled to the ground from Powell, which allowed Tootle to get in behind the Cheltenham back four.
Burgess, it's that combination again, albeit inside the Cheltenham half. Summerfield, John Batty, Moore. Smith, Moore, and it came across, just held up the Crewe flow. Leach Smith staying out wide. Very nearly took him in behind Garbutt, who will settle for giving away the corner.
Well, it wasn't the greatest first touch again. The ball sprayed wide by Luke Murphy. Kicking out Leach Smith. Just managed to keep it in play. In the end, Garbutt's got to make a challenge, and Crewe come away with the corner.
Crewe set out their stall for their first corner kick. Got the touch by Elliott. And a goal in the first leg against Southend came from a set piece. Dugdale's header. Here's Powell, they're standing off him, and he very nearly made them pay again.
He is a whisker away from making it 2-0. It does really well. He uses his wide play as a decoy. John Batty thinks he's going to play in Tootle down the left-hand side when he cuts in field here. I think he's going to play this ball. He doesn't. Takes an extra touch. He just strikes across that ball. It's always going away from that far post rather than curling back in. It's the way that he strikes the ball, which means it's always just going to drift wide.
Running in, it was last ditch, but it was effective, and just as importantly, it was fair.
It was a crucial touch from Luke Murphy. This ball bounces up. McGlashan got away from the attentions of the Crewe defenders. We're going to get to this ball first, but Murphy doing a brilliant job on the cover. Times his challenge brilliantly. It's the job of it. Defensive midfield, you've got to get back in there at times into your own penalty area, make challenges, and that's a superb one.
It's another one of the marks of this current crop of Crewe players, academy graduates, that many of them are versatile, can play in different positions, whether it be along the back or across the midfield area. Goulding, Pack, Powell doing the tackling on the edge of his own penalty area, and effectively finding Leach Smith. Now Crewe throwing a few bodies forward. Westwood. And Powell might just make up the ground as it holds up on this dry Wembley turf. Tootle, Leach Smith. Leach Smith is onside. He's forced wide, goes for the cutback, and that allows the block for the corner.
Well, Alan Bennett does really well here. It's difficult for AJ Leach Smith. The ball just sits up, putting ball over the top. He's just about onside. Powell plays him in. The ball just sits up. It's difficult for him to strike first time. And Bennett does well. He stays on his feet, watches the ball, and he's just to smuggle it away.
Thank you. Martel was the near post runner. Fizzed in by Westward, and Elliott got his head to it. Element of it could have gone anywhere. We talked about experience defending from Alan Bennett. This time, Steve Elliott does brilliantly, virtually on top of his own goalkeeper, just lets it skim off the top of his head, does really well. There's one he certainly needed to get right. Player who played in the Premier League for Derby County, Steve Elliott. Described in the programme today as the experienced barrel-chested centre-half. Westwood's corner, the keeper's blocked off. And the free header wasn't capitalised from Kelvin Mellor.
Oh, it's sloppy from Cheltenham, we just don't deal with it at all. No one reacts quick enough. And Mellor's on the move, gets in behind John Batty, gets up. And he'll be disappointed. He needs to keep this down. If he keeps this on target, he's so close, he probably scores.
He has scored once this season, coming into the side in this last dozen games of the season, Kelvin Mellor. John Batty. Murphy. Davis. Moore. John Batty read the power pass. Westwood trying to get it in for Lee Smith. Very nearly, very good, but Elliott has the match for it. His way through that challenge. Link spotting a gap, driving for it. But I don't think he's got the pace to get beyond that pair, has he?
We need to see a little bit more of that from Jeff Goulding, just stepping away from Dugdale and Artel, getting the ball into his feet, giving those two centre-halves a much bigger problem.
Garbutt's cross could turn out to be awkward. Artel read that danger.
Where Crewe really do need to stand firm just before half-time. It's a really dangerous ball in. Martel, he makes that his. There's no way on earth a Cheltenham player is going to get to that before him.
They're going to put the pressure on Steve Phillips. Goulding and Mohamed standing close. It's a well-worked routine, but without the end product. Summerfield's run found him in excellent space, but he couldn't find the shot. So Cheltenham reload, Pack's corner. And tipped over the crossbar. Cheltenham are coming on strong at the end of this half. Goulding's header.
It's a decent save, it's a decent height though for Steve Phillips. Sees it all the way as well and just gets a big palm on it. And it will be a danger. They're a big side, Cheltenham. It's not an easy header for Goulding. There's no real power on it, no real pace there. And the keeper can just tip it over the bar easily.
Mohamed!
There's a few times in this half the ball has fallen to Khalid Mohamed, and on his right foot, he's got excited at every opportunity. He just needs to control this. Just put his foot through it, he just goes for power again, he just needs to hit the target. I wonder Mark Yates can't believe it, they've had some good opportunities, and they've just not worked the keeper enough.
Bennett. Didn't get that quite where he wanted it. Tuchel has Got it here for Crewe. Leach-Smith. Bennett's touch. And Nick Powell was adjudged to be backing into him.
Well, this first half, it's been all about composure. Nick Powell, really composed, brilliant finish. But there have been chances for Cheltenham. They just got a little excited in front of goal for Goulding and Mohammed. And I'm sure that's what Mark Yates will say to his team at half-time. We just need to be more composed. Take it easy in front of goal. And a nice, solid connection. Don't get excited and slash at that ball wildly.
For Goulding again, here's McGlashan. Well, the route to opportunity does seem to be route one here for Cheltenham Town as they seek a equaliser in the 3 minutes of added time.
So close to the break, it's understandable that Cheltenham are just going to pump this ball forward and hope something breaks. McGlashan gets covered here, is it Mellor that just catches him, and there's no foul in there. Ball bounces up, it's Mellor who clears the ball. It's an accidental collision, but a painful one for Jermaine McGlashan.
Drills low, hoping for a break. Mohammed off the line again. Crewe having to throw everything at it to try and keep Cheltenham out here. McGlashan.
Oh, just won't go in for Mohammed. Steve Elliott cannot believe it. They're pressing and pressing. On two occasions this is cleared off the line. Elliott's the first one with his header. And this is the second one when it breaks for Mohammed. This time he does keep his cool. And he's saying that ball is over the line. Very hard to tell.
Held in by Pack. Summerfield can only fire wide.
Just need to see whether this shot for Mohammed, does it go over the line? It breaks nicely to him. Lovely controlled strike. Is it over the line? No, it isn't. The hold of the ball is definitely not over the line. That's a quite brilliant clearance.
For Leach-Smith. Well, they might not have their equaliser, but they have certainly had their opportunities, Cheltenham. Ashley Westwood with the sort of block that can turn a match, that can win a playoff.
We have instincts down one end to score goals and key moments in games, but Ashley Westwood, his instinct there to get back on the line and to react so quickly when the shot came in, wasn't easy to clear it, and he did really well.
First half that in the searing sunshine has certainly entertained. It's a League Two playoff final thus far that's lived up to expectations, as has this young man. What a goal it is that separates the sides. Nick Powell, 16th of the season, means half-time here at Wembley in the League Two playoff final. It is Cheltenham Town 0, Crewe Alexandra 1.
And what a contrast to yesterday. 120 minutes without a goal yesterday. We waited just 15 today. And what a terrific fight back from Cheltenham. But history is against them. We'll hear from Grant McCann, Neil Lennon, Peter Beagrie on a wonder goal that has put Crewe 45 minutes from League One. At Wembley, an absolute scorcher of a goal from Nick Powell has given Crewe a 1-0 lead against Cheltenham at half-time in the League Two playoff final. Grant McCann, Neil Lennon and Peter Beagrie alongside me. We gave Nick Powell the big up at the start of the show. He hasn't disappointed. And Neil, given the context of this game, what a strike.
It's a goal that would, you know, fit any occasion. It's a magnificent goal that epitomises the way Crewe have played first half. Beautifully worked between the left-back and the midfielder, and then it's into Powell. And the way he shifts his body and cuts the ball back onto his left foot. The first touch is excellent, but the second touch is just absolutely magnificent. What a goal.
Grant, you scored a few memorable goals in your time. There's something a little bit Henry-esque about this, isn't there?
It's the, I think, this, as Neil says, his touch made it. You know, the way he's pulled it back onto his right foot was different class. And You know, the lads look lively the whole game. He's picking up in little spaces and stuff. He looks a real threat for Crewe.
Peter, Cheltenham have been caught in two minds about how they pick him up.
Yeah, well, I think after the first few minutes, we said about the combination play, and Lee Smith went in behind. The two centre-halves dropped deep, frightened of his pace, and he goes and operates just in behind the two central midfield players. They think he's occupying them, and he's picked up, and then he finds space, and so that they have found it a real problem to pick him up.
And Crewe had a great chance to make it 2-0. Kevin Mellor with the opportunity. Neil, how big an opportunity was this?
That's a chance, there's no doubt about it. And if he directs that on target, it's a goal. You know, Jumbadi gets under the ball and Mellor gets a run on him, and really he should be doing better from 4 yards out. But it's interesting the fact that Crewe were a threat at set pieces when really Cheltenham were the bigger team. And Burgess, particularly as the half wore on, you know, started to get the better of the centre-half for Crewe.
And in truth, it took Cheltenham the longer of the two sides to settle here at Wembley. But Grant, once they did, and once that goal had gone in, the response was impressive.
I was just saying, the Neil watching it there, you know, once Cheltenham started passing the ball a little bit more, I still think the wingers can do a bit more by getting the ball in the box to Burgess, because he's definitely a handful and he's causing them all sorts of problems. But yeah, Cheltenham looked a different team since Crewe scored.
And is what lacking, Peter, for Cheltenham at the moment? Just that little bit of composure?
It is. It's that final little bit of execution, the bit of presence, the bit of poise, as Powell showed. And I mean, that's a terrific strike, I have to say, to keep the ball down half volley like that, get it on target. But talk about due diligence, clean it off the line, absolutely fantastic by Westwood. You know, you thought it was a goal for the life here, and a fantastic clearance. And that's what Crewe have added to their game under Steve Davis. They've been stronger and more resolute and have the ability to hold on to a one-goal lead, but they will be under severe pressure this second half.
Neil, can you see Crewe keeping out Cheltenham for another 45 minutes, given the way Cheltenham finished that half?
I think there's goals in this for Cheltenham, unless Crewe get a grip of Burgess. You know, he's winning a lot in the air, and the likes of Mohamed and McGlashan are picking up the pieces and causing Crewe all sorts of problems. That Crewe have got to stop the supply into him and then deal with it better on the second balls. Otherwise, they're going to be in for a long second half.
Lovely turn, and what a goal that is! That is why he is so talked about. Top class from Nick Powell.
His 16th goal of the season, and Peter, when you consider that only one side in 26 years of the playoffs at this level have overturned a first-half deficit, how did Cheltenham go about their business in the second half?
Much the same as they did, get the ball in the box at every opportunity. They've got options on the bench, top scorer Duffy. They've also got big James Spencer there, who's an aerial threat. Got another winger in Schmeichel for Crewe to profit in this game. They need big performances from the two centre-halves and their goalkeeper to take the pressure off them.
And it would appear, Neil, from how that first half finished, it'll be tough for Crewe to hang on for another 45 minutes. So do they start the second half like they started the first?
Yeah, they started the game very well, so they need to get back on the front foot. If they can pinch another goal, great, but you know that there'll be a storm coming from Cheltenham eventually. They'll try and get the ball in the box at every opportunity, but I've been really impressed with Westwood in midfield and Lee Smith up front alongside Powell. I think there's goals in it for Crewe as well.
Let's find out in the company of Annie Hinchcliffe and Bill Leslie once again.
So Crewe it is, who are in the driving seat at half-time, ready to end their three seasons at this level, ready to start their climb again and get their first promotion from this level since 1994. Cheltenham, who have this proud playoff record, with it all to do, no changes for either side for this second half. But I dare say that Cheltenham would have been highly encouraged after their shaky start, with the way that they had double the chances, double the shots on target, and the side who lead them at half-time.
An interesting team talks for both managers. I saw Mark Yates would have said to his team, look, we need to continue how we ended that first half. Let's not go to sleep in the break and start slowly in the second half. Take the game to Crewe. I'm sure Steve Davis has said to his players, look, we can't sit back on 1-0 for 45 minutes and try and see the job through. They are a side who love to go forward. They have to look to get another goal.
Goulding, Mohamed, corner. Well-known Premier League fullback Luke Garbutt from Everton, well, far in the corner. Burgess, who'd made a run across, couldn't get enough contact on that. And Dugdale's the man down. It's not, it's David Artell.
Yeah, any set pieces, certainly corners, it's going to be tough for Crew. They've got to stand firm. Both centre-halves come up for Cheltenham. And they're a big side, so you've got to be brave. And Artel has certainly taken a whack there.
Well, he is, of course, the player for Crew who is playing through the pain barrier. Broken metatarsal. After the first leg of the playoff semi-final, he was on crutches with a protective boot. Miraculous recovery to play in the second leg at Roots Hall.
He's never easier, a big physical side. Steve Elliott is, who jumps alongside him, just maybe as he lands. Awkwardly, you've got a broken bone in your foot. Every time you jump and land, it's going to be very, very painful. I'm sure there's maybe a pain-killing injection or two in that foot just to get him through this final.
But when you have a centre-half whose nickname is The Rock landing on it, you're going to know about it. Looks to be OK, though, to continue, doesn't he? David Artel. Well, Cheltenham it was, of course, who finished 5 points better off than Crew over the 46 games of the League Two season. But Crew did the double over them. They've won the last three meetings between the clubs. Challenge. He's done really well there, Jermaine McGlashan. Linesman's flag on the far side means he's got a free kick as well.
Oh, it's great tenacity, chasing Tootle all the way back, sliding in, winning the ball, getting straight on his feet. And running straight at the defence. This is brilliant wide play. That's what you've got to do as a wide player. It's not all about attacking play. You've got to work back. He does that. He's certainly clipped there and goes to ground, picks up the free kick.
This is a Cheltenham strength, and they will be hoping a true weakness, I think, with the likes of Burgess around. Elliott, who's come forward from the back. Mohamed, who can be pretty good in the air at times as well. Garbutt whips it in. By Summerfield, it's not where he intended it to go. That's why Crew can clear. Garbutt, McGlashan. Nolan Pack. And by Summerfield. Here's Mohamed. The run of Summerfield outside him. Luke Summerfield was getting ready to pull the trigger when Harry Davis just got a boot in there.
Yeah, Davis does really well. It's about concentration. You see a player running beyond you. You've got to watch the ball. You've got to watch the attacker as well.
Phillips, you've got to gather. Well, they've started this second half where they left off the first, haven't they, Cheltenham? Looking the most likely. Of the way that Crew have come back into the reckoning from what was looking like a relegation battle to the brink of promotion here. New year, Cheltenham with 13 places and 19 points ahead of Steve Davis's Crew. It was only about 6 weeks into the job then, Steve Davis. And he's been around the club for a long time, both as a player and a coach behind the scenes. Knows about the Crew way, and he knew what he needed to add, what he felt he needed to add to make them competitive. Goodness me, has he done that? 18 games unbeaten. It's a club record run in a single season. Summerfield. Mohamed. Pack. Oh, just wide from Marlon Pack.
Really patient build-up from Cheltenham. He does everything right, Marlon Pack, because this is really a difficult strike ball coming across your body. You saw in the semi-final with a free kick he scored, he can strike a mean ball. He's under pressure as well. He's just trying to keep that away from the goalkeeper, but try and drift it inside that right-hand post. And it's a difficult skill, and he's a whisker away from equalising.
A He was here as a Portsmouth fan. He's from that part of the world, the Buckland area of Portsmouth. He's got his extended family here. Upwards of 30 tickets he requested for the final so they could all come and watch him here. He's had an excellent season. He was on a real low after being released by Portsmouth last summer.
He is Cheltenham's playmaker. He's a player that they need to get on the ball. We see how devastating he can be with his shooting. He's a player in this second half that really needs to come to the fore if Cheltenham are to get back into the game.
Voted by his peers, Marlon Pack, as well in the PFA League Two Team of the Year. Moore. Davis. Leach-Smith. Broken out by Summerfield, something he did so effectively, particularly in that first leg of the semi-final, when he won man of the match against Torquay. Moore. Ground for McGlashan to make up. Very nearly did it. Clutch from Mellor and a corner for Crewe, out of nothing really.
It's a fantastic race between McGlashan and Mellor. So McGlashan trying to get the Cheltenham fans going on that goal that they're attacking now, but it's just chased that ball down and did really well to get a corner out of pretty much nothing.
And around 10,000 Cheltenham fans packed into that end of the stadium that side are attacking in the second half. Swept away by Powell. Everyone's been pulled back to defend the corner, so there's plenty of time here for John Batty. Burgess. Martell away. Byron Moore. Westwood. Summerfield breaking it up, typically tenacious style. Pack, run through the middle from Mohamed. Might get a bit lucky, Mohamed! Fine save from Phillips. Well, the luck was involved with the way that the ball broke to him, but there was no luck in the save from Phillips, who smothered it in fine style.
When it fell to Mohamed's left foot, I felt he's either going to take it round the keeper or certainly put it past him. Absolutely right, Steve Phillips does well, he stays on his feet, very experienced goalkeeper, didn't give Mohamed anything to shoot at. In the end, it's a poor finish, but a decent save.
Scott Brown fires it deep. Too deep for Ben Burgess to get anything on it. He's had some chances this afternoon, though, Khaled Mohamed.
This all comes again from Marlon Pack, getting on the ball, being the creator. Bit of good fortune here. He definitely has a good look at the goal. He has a choice whether to go round the keeper or take the shot on. He goes for the shot, but he just maybe gets stuck underneath his feet a little bit. Doesn't catch it cleanly. You've got to give the keeper credit. He stays on his feet. He makes himself big, and it's a good stop.
Summerfield leading the Cheltenham charge again. You would suspect, given that the pattern from the first half's continued, that Crewe will be looking to keep hold of the ball. That's their strength. They haven't been allowed to, though. Summerfield has become much more of a force. Powell much less of a force in the last 20-25 minutes of action over both halves.
The bulk of the chances are going Cheltenham's way, but it's all about taking them. Some good opportunities, but it's all about putting that ball away. And we get an equaliser, everything changes.
Leach-Smith appealing for handball. Referee Craig Pawson's not going to give it. McGlashan. He's given it to Powell. second for Leach Smith. He's the only survivor, actually, at the club of the last Cheltenham playoff success. Back at the Millennium Stadium in 2006, he was an unused substitute. And they beat Grimsby Town. John Ward, the manager. Of Burgess, even though Dugdale has the beating of him for pace, but they do have a throw in deep Crewe territory.
It's not glamorous from the keeper, Scott Brown, long kick downfield. If they don't allow Crewe to clear their lines easily, then they pick the ball up in a dangerous area, long throw.
Just taken by Garbutt. Moore. Westwood, Leach Smith. Tuchel's made a run forward. Here he is, looking for the return to Leach Smith.
Leach Smith is one of those players who's always on the move, little give and go there. He's always looking to find some space, get in behind defenders. Alan Bennett, very experienced, did really well, just put himself in between Leach Smith and the ball and just shepherds it out for a goal kick.
Come out to deal with him this time. Pack closing in. Murphy did well to get out of a tight situation. Dugdale's ball. Smith, good strength, but excellent defending from Bennett. Mohammed. Foul. That's the hour mark now, and still that moment of magic from Nick Powell on the quarter of an hour mark is what separates the sides. Cheltenham have huffed and puffed, seeing one's come back off the crossbar, one's blocked off the line. Here's Elliott, back across goal. Mohammed by Dugdale. And a free kick for Crewe.
And it's so important for Crewe when those long balls are played into their penalty area. They do react to the second ball. Steve Elliott wins the first header. Crewe do really well to react once that header comes in from Elliott. And they manage to guide it clear and then pick up the free kick and clear their lines. But it's not easy. His long balls are pumped forward. Elliott gets onto this. He's about reacting when this header comes across. Crewe do really well. 1-2 players attacking that ball. Pick up the free kick. And they can breathe again.
Pal. Moore. was a challenge from Garber that needed to be spot on, and it was just that.
There's a bit of reason for fullbacks from wingers actually run you into the penalty area. They're looking maybe for a bit of contact. Is that the timing of your challenge? And Luke Garber gets this one spot on. Never easy. He watches the ball. This is really good defending and slides in brilliantly.
Westwood. Back out to Ashley Westwood here, who goes low this time. Stabbed away by Marlon Pack. Lee Smith coming back from an offside position there, and the flag goes up. Given the way that Crewe have played throughout their unbeaten run, there was one match in Oxford actually when they were really under the cosh. That was back in January. Steve Davis will tell you that was a real turning point in terms of belief. They thrived on adversity. They don't have an unbeaten run of the length that they have without it. Cox overhit that one. And you feel in the remaining time here they're really going to have to dig deep, because Cheltenham are only going to increase the pressure, increase the aerial bombardment as the match ticks on and the stakes get higher, the tension rises, all those usual playoff final qualities come into play.
You see Steve Davis there trying to get his fans going, get the tempo raised, get the atmosphere lifted. And then you see him there just telling his players to start passing the ball again. That's what Crewe are so good at. They are going to have to defend in numbers as Cheltenham press them back, but they have to be brave in possession and start putting 10, 15 passes together to take the sting out of the game.
This is better what they were doing earlier on. Powell saw it blocked by Bennett. And Summerfield got enough on that just. Garber gets it away, but not out of play. Baron Moore. Run from Leach Smith. He went to the near post. Tootle loses out to John Batty. Supporters, they'll tell you that they were first to sing it ahead of your old boys Manchester City.
I thought it was Crewe Moon, but it's definitely Blue Moon, is it?
Burgess. Pack. Summerfield. Now Leach Smith. Powell makes his move out to the left. Nick Powell. Tootle trying to dance away from John Batty, who holds him up well, allows support to come back, and the danger averted for now. But here's Nick Powell. Cheltenham defending manfully, dealing with everything that Crewe could throw at them for now. Garbutt. Summerfield. Getting himself in a little bit of a tangle there, Mohammed.
Just looking to lay that ball off for Goulding, who made a little run round him. First time we really see Cheltenham get the ball on the floor into the feet of their strikers, and the idea was right for Mohammed. Just the execution, just stumbled over the ball.
Summerfield. Mohammed. Goulding wants it outside. Mohammed. Ball to nowhere. Here's Leach Smith. Westwood. Murphy. Powell. Tootle. Not exactly from Nick Powell what his manager would have wanted him to do in that possession.
The game has certainly dropped in tempo though, and that's understandable. Halfway through the second half, it's very, very hot down there. The pitch saps your energy as well, and both sides seem to be struggling. You've got to be strong mentally and physically in these conditions to stick at it. Cheltenham to get back into the game and Crewe to maybe get a second.
Hyde Mahat. Summerfield. Pack. John Batty. He's having endeared himself to the Cheltenham Town supporters this year after his recruitment from non-league football. Flag has gone up against Ben Burgess. Maybe time for the drinks break. A quarter of the contest remaining.
I do get a sense, and that's maybe what the players needed since half-time. It's really slipped into a bit of a lull. That, of course, will suit Crewe there. One goal to the good. Cheltenham very keen to keep the tempo high. Not easy in these conditions.
Well, Cheltenham's winning run in four games. Severely under threat, the last side to beat them, the only side in the last six to get the better of them, Crewe. And the scoreline was, as it stands at the moment, 1-0. You look at all the efforts they've had. There's still plenty of time, of course, Andy, to do something about it. But you think of the goal line clearances, particularly from Ashley Westwood. You think of Goulding firing against the crossbar. And you think of this moment, and maybe you think it's not your day.
Cheltenham have had their chances, but when you've got a top young player like this in your side, you've always got the ability to grab a goal, possibly the winning goal, and just absolute perfection. His first touch and his finish, you won't see better than that during the course of the season. One of the goals of the season, you'd have to say, in League Two.
Crewe had a wonderful win at Gillingham where he scored what was voted the club's goal of the season. You might have seen it with us in the build-up. Right footer from some distance into the top corner. His left peg. And the crop of graduates that promises much again, echoing the golden produce of the past at Gresty Road. He is the star that shines the brightest, Nick Powell. Garbutt. Tootle. Leach-Smith. Murphy. Matt Tootle. Leach-Smith. Mella. Burgess. To get it on for Goulding. Pack. He was a striker when he was a kid at Portsmouth there from the age of nine. He's a big midfield player, 6'4" of him. This is Khaid Mohammed. Two in the box for him to aim at. Phillips able to get enough of a grasp on it to smother any danger.
Really good position again from Steve Phillips, all about experience, but this is where Cheltenham need Mohammed running at Harry Davis. Just can't pull this ball far enough away from the goalkeeper. Excellent concentration, good handling from the Crewe keeper.
Garbutt.
Thank you.
a needless free kick to give away, really, Steve Elliott.
Just a really tired challenge from Steve Elliott. Just stumbles into the back of Nick Powell. That's all he's looking for, it's to shove. As he goes to ground, the referee's always going to give the free kick.
Cheltenham construct their wall. It's what Westwood or Murphy has to aim at. Westwood looks to drop it in behind. Super save on the line by Brown. Tootle. And out by Summerfield. Murphy. Here's Leach Smith. McGlashan. Having a run up this left now. Byron Moore matching him stride for stride before he just had a little nibble. Byron Moore was so keen not to make a challenge because he knew that McGlashan is looking to possibly go to ground. He's running really down a cul-de-sac. There's cover on there for Crewe as well. All McGlashan is looking for is the free kick. You see Byron Moore running alongside him, not really wanting to make any type of challenge. And to me, there's not a lot of contact there. But this was a chance for Dugdale really to kill the game off. Scott Brown does absolutely brilliantly to keep his concentration, get a really strong left arm on this. This doesn't sit down for Dugdale, but brave keeping. He's kept Cheltenham in this game.
And here they are, up at the other end. Free kick of their own. And by Pack. Pack enlists the help of John Batty. Summerfield!
I can only think maybe Luke Summerfield's going for goal here, but the angle's certainly against him. It was headed on by Alan Bennett. It's a good run from Summerfield. Maybe we'd better serve here, trying to just help this into the six-yard box. He's going for goal there. There's some goal from there. So put that into the top corner.
Time for a change for Cheltenham. Darrell Duffy, who's had a blonde rinse for the final, comes on. Replacing Jeff Goulding, he is the top scorer, making his 50th appearance for the club, looking to add to his 15 goals that he has this season.
This was always an option for Mark Yates with the two strikers on the bench in Duffy and Spencer. He's gone for Darrell Duffy, top scorer for Cheltenham. They need a goal.
Patience for them. No time to reach for any sort of panic button yet. Here's Duffy. Crowded out by Murphy. Pack in with the challenge. It's come to McGlashan. Pack on the ball again. Duffy. Find a way through to McGlashan. Smith against Bennett. Nick Powell. Moore. And that's excellent covering from Garber, the fullback tracking him all the way.
Oh, that is absolutely outstanding. He probably knows Luke Garber is going to play more onside, but he's got to stay with him.
He's got to time his tackle correctly. A couple of occasions now, he's done really well.
Intended target is Burgess again. Moore. And use that fascinating duel he's got with Garbutt. Powell. Elliot out swiftly to block him. Westwood. Powell. Moore. There's a wrestling match in the box there. And can I say a sigh of relief as nothing's given against Marlon Pack. Summerfield. Duffy. Mohammed. McGlashan. Too detailed to stop him do their job. Pack. And Marlon Pack involved and Luke Murphy there for a penalty shout.
There's a big call from Greg Pawson's. The ball's played in. There seems to be a bit of pushing and shoving. Marlon Pack certainly got an arm round Luke Murphy. The referee seems to be in a decent position. He's got a good look at this. There seems to be some contact there. They're certainly going to get to the ball first, the Crewe player. The referee's in an excellent position, a very good view, and never even budges. And to me, there's a definite shout there for a penalty.
Slippery, twisting, turning and eventually drawing the foul from Elliott.
So many attributes, Nick Powell. We know he's a goal scorer, but great balance and awareness of where defenders are around him, and he doesn't mind having the ball in tight areas. Great skill as well, and it's away from Steve Elliott. There's a slip there, there's a bit of a nudge as well. In these conditions, he's always going to go to ground and take the free kick and just eat into the clock.
Grady working up a sweat, working on the suntan. Trying to one of his proteges, Steve Davis, to feel the real heat down in the dugout to try and get Crewe across this finishing line. And he came so close from the last set piece from this situation with Dugdale coming in at the far post. He's taken up a similar position. In the meantime, it's Max Clayton time. Off the bench to score the decisive goal in the playoff semi-final at Southend. He'll come on for the remaining 10 minutes or so here at Wembley. Nick Powell has already taken his moment in the sun, and Crewe supporters looking on. Can't help but feel maybe this is the last they'll have seen of him in a Crewe Alexandra shirt. If that contribution he's made is to be the winning goal, what a way to sign off. That's not for now, that's for about 10 minutes' time. Westwood. Summerfield got his head to it. So Crewe can have the corner. And with 10 minutes to play, this is exactly where they will want to be.
It's a really important defensive header from Summerfield because he's worried about what's behind him. But the Crewe player's looking to get a header in on goal, and all he can do is just help that ball on.
Everyone bar Jermaine McGlashan pulled back here for Cheltenham. Dugdale came at the near post. Back in by Byron Moore. Moore, lovely touch. Byron Moore, just wide.
Oh, he works the space for himself absolutely brilliantly. He suckers a couple of defenders. They think he's going to take the shot early. This is not easy in a crowded penalty area, just to shift this ball onto his left foot. Just the last thing he needs is to scuff that ball, just needs to catch it cleanly. A really decent left foot. Just snatches at it, that's a really good opportunity for Moore.
Pack. Giambatti. Mohammed didn't quite get his head to it. Stabbed away by Dugdale. Leach Smith. Westwood. Moore just checks up on this bone-dry Wembley pitch. Leach-Smith. Moore! And that should be that! Byron Moore with his 10th goal of the season. It's his best ever scoring season, and he probably has sealed Crewe's return to League One.
Well, he's so patient. This is what Crewe have done all season. Low expectations at the start of the season, but they've just continually built, playing quality football, patient build-up football. That's all they do here. They don't rush it. They just keep possession and work an angle for Byron Moore. He had a poor shot a minute or so ago with his left foot, but when it's on his right, he does well. He hits the target, keeps the ball down, but it's patient. They're looking tired, Cheltenham. They're looking laboured when they go forward, but Crewe are just patient. Plays it into Leach-Smith, just makes an angle. Lets the ball run across his body, and it's a really tidy finish. And at 2-0, it's an awfully long way back now for Cheltenham, but this is excellent work from Byron Moore. Doesn't panic, makes his move at the right time. It's a really confident finish.
Well, fitting given the Crewe philosophy that both their goals scored by their academy graduates. Nick Powell with the first, Byron Moore with the second. 7 minutes of normal time to play. Two changes for Cheltenham to try and bridge this two-goal chasm that they have to if they're going to even take it to extra time. Marlon Pack departing the stage. Russell Penn, his replacement, Jimmy Spencer, striker who started both of the semi-finals, also coming on. Use all their changes, and they're going to rue all their missed chances. And by Garbutt. Certainly against Cheltenham. You know, talking about that playoff tie yesterday, weren't we? It was the last one at Wembley, settled on penalty shootouts between Gillingham and Manchester City. It's the last time a deficit such as this was overturned at this stage in playoff history. Defensive-minded Carl Martin coming on to try and make sure that Cheltenham don't get any chink of a opening to get back into this match. Cheltenham's perfect playoff record. Twice they've contested the playoff at this level, twice they have succeeded. It's about to be ended by Crewe, who about this time a year ago, 13 months ago in fact, inflicted one of the low points of Mark Yates's reign, an 8-1 defeat, which led to a lot of soul searching, to a summer of rebuilding, and led to a season this year which has surpassed expectations, even as you would suspect this two-goal deficit is too much for Cheltenham to come back from. Let's not forget, for them, it has been an excellent season. They were among the favourites for relegation at the start of it. And on an afternoon where there always has to be one that misses out, it looks like it will be them.
It doesn't matter what happens here. Mark Yates is very, very proud of his side and how hard they've worked this season to get to this point. It will be heartbreaking if they, of course, don't go up. At the end of the game, if they don't make it, it'll be down to the missed chances, really good opportunities they've had in the game.
this afternoon's attendance, 24,029.
He looks stunned, doesn't he? Wasn't supposed to end like this, not when, at the beginning of March, they were nicely cemented in the top two. Moore is offside. For the month in which they played seven games, didn't win one, only picked up 1 point. That's when it all started going wrong. They had an excellent recovery, did well against the Torquay side, who were beset by disappointment themselves, to book this place at Wembley. McGlashan. Elliott.
The big difference, though, for Cheltenham between the semi-finals, the two legs, and this final is that when chances have come along, they've not taken them. Torquay had plenty of chances in those semi-finals, didn't take them. Cheltenham did. In the final here at Wembley, good chances have come and gone, and Crewe have played well. They've scored two excellent goals. Can't take that away from Crewe, but I'm sure Mark Yates will say to his players, we needed to be more ruthless.
Well, every playoff final has its massive moments, and you think back to that goal line clearance that he made from Khaled Mohammed in the first half. They were really under the cosh, the start of this half and the end of the last. Now Crewe very much in the comfort zone. Tootle. Clayton. Byron Moore, might be another here!
Oh, this would have been the icing on the cake. It's really good play from Max Clayton. Just gets his body in the way of defenders and just rolls that ball back into the path of Byron Moore. Gets it out of his feet really well. It's a good opportunity, just drags it wide, and it was a real opportunity to kill the game off.
Summerfield. Well, Cheltenham need to keep believing. There will be a fairly hefty chunk of added time at the end. One goal would certainly make it interesting, but at the same time, will they leave themselves open at the other? Moore. Bennett came quite close to giving away something that. Clayton. Fine save by Brown. Just about keeps him in it.
Oh, Max Clayton does everything right as the ball comes across his body, strikes it well enough. It's a really super save.
Davis. Well, six added minutes. Summerfield. Seeking McGlashan, who was holding him to lose out in an aerial battle. Carl Martin, fresh legs. Clayton wanted the early ball, it's to Byron Moore. Now Clayton gets it. Tootle in the centre. The 17-year-old. Is it blocked away by the significantly more experienced Bennett, 13 years his senior.
The second Crewe goal has really knocked the stuffing out of Cheltenham. They look really tired now, and the substitutions that Crewe have made, really lively and looking for a third.
And the man you see in your picture there, Khaled Mohammed, will probably leave with more regrets than most. He had the lion's share of really good chances.
Big opportunity, wasn't it, when the scoreline was 1-0 and he broke in behind the Cheltenham defence. Steve Phillips made a decent save, but really that's the defining moment, maybe, that clearance off the line from Westwood. That's a big, big moment in the game as well, but Mohammed will be disappointed he's not scored today.
And just after that moment of magic from Nick Powell, Goulding
firing one from range against the crossbar. And providing Cheltenham with what-if moments. Still got just over 4 minutes of added time to try and force the unlikely, but you do sense the shoulders have just started to go down. Time and the heat bears down and the scoreline glares down, you do start to feel a little sorry for yourselves, so near but yet so far. Start. Mind you, those Manchester City fans here against Gillingham all left early, didn't they? They had to run along the tube tracks to come back when it went to extra time.
We've seen it at Wembley before, we've seen it at the Etihad as well, it's not unthinkable. It would be very, very surprising now if Cheltenham were to turn this around or give themselves a chance of taking the game to extra time.
Not impossible, but increasingly improbable. Who started the match the stronger, finish it the stronger. Cheltenham enjoyed the superiority throughout the middle section of it. And it's not going to be enough. Mohamed. Garbutt. Proud moments for so many involved in Crewe Alexandra. Pride about to become elation and about to become promotion. Need to make one more substitution in the 6 minute of added time. Clayton, Moore. Martin. And the Crewe supporters dusted off the Olays. McGlashan. John Batty. Summerfield wants it, but John Batty driving through. There's Dugdale. John Batty. And in the dying seconds, there's a Cheltenham corner. Crewe will now use the opportunity to make their change. Kelvin Mellor. Will come off to make way for Lee Bell. Well, I think they want to change the substitution. They want to bring off Byron Moore rather. Board malfunction. So they're not going to take off a defender before a corner, they're going to take off the scorer of the second goal.
such shenanigans, which take us toward the 8th added minute here. This season, with their philosophy and their brand of football, they have now won promotion back to League One. A final that they started so well and took the lead in sensational style through Nick Powell. They had to really dig deep, show the other side of their character as Cheltenham carved out chance after chance, which they failed to take. And then the crucial blow struck late in the second half by Byron Moore to seal the deal for Crewe Alexandra, who probably just about edged it on the day.
It was an incredible run to get into the playoffs from Crewe Alexandra. And what they were at Wembley was more clinical. Great finishing from Powell and Byron Moore. That's the difference between the two sides. You don't take your chances in big games like this. It's not going to work out for you. But 19 games unbeaten. You've got to congratulate Crewe on that promotion.
Crewe started in February after they lost at Southend. Their confidence and their swagger grew and grew and grew. It has taken them from the brink of relegation, 18th, when Steve Davis took over, to League One. Let's hear from Steve Davis. He's with Greg Whelan.
Steve, you're taking Crewe Alexandra back into League One in your first season. How proud are you at this moment?
Very proud, very emotional. You know, fantastic for the lads. You know, it's a very, very young team, so hopefully we can keep them together and continue with the success. They've done fantastic today.
When you took over in November, could you possibly have imagined the campaign ending like this?
Not at all. Obviously, you know, we're 18th, you know, we're really struggling. And it's just build that confidence and, you know, this is what we've seen today. This is the end product of it all, if you like. So we've done a fantastic, job.
19 games unbeaten. What's been the key?
Just confidence and, you know, we get results and the players feel better and just get more confident. And they're just resilient. They don't know when they're beaten now. So, no, it's just improving that mental strength. And they, as they get a bit older, they're starting to develop it now, you know. So I'm really proud of them.
Two great goals. Tremendous first goal from Nick Powell in what could be his last game for the club. How pleased are you for him?
Yeah, he's been fantastic. You know, he got the Player of the Year awards, and rightly so. He's our most talented player at the moment, and he's got a great future, and that's the sort of things he can produce.
Great day for Crewe Alexandra. How special a day for the Davis family?
Very special. Obviously, Harry's come through as well, and the wife and family up there, so they'll be very proud and very emotional. I think they'll be crying with a few tears up there today.
Steve, many congratulations.
Thanks a lot. Cheers.
What a job he's done. They were 18th when he took over on November the 10th. Well, let's hear from the man he's just been talking about, Nick Powell, and also Ashley Westwood there alongside Patrick Davison.
Nick, Ashley, many congratulations. Nick, together through the academy now, together you won promotion at Wembley. How special is this?
Well, I've been here 12 years and Ashley's been here a long, long time as well. I'm one of the youngest, but I feel one of the oldest anyway.
Talk us through the goal, because that's the sort of thing you dream of in the back garden, isn't it? We knew you were good. I don't think we knew you were that good.
If I'm honest, I just whacked it. Man, there was nothing in that. I just whacked it.
At what point did you realise you were going to have a crack? Because the first touch was pretty special as well.
Well, I knew the guy was away to my left, so I thought, I've got this space, I might as well have a go.
Ashley, just as important as Nick's goal, your clearance off the line.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't know much about it. It's come at me like a rocket. And lucky enough, I've got something on it to get it off the line.
Did you think it was over?
Yes, no. It come like a rocket, mate. I haven't got a clue.
Where's this come from? I think when Steve Davis took over, you were 18th with 19 points. What changed?
Just the intensity in the training. I mean, all the lads are together. We've got a great team spirit. We've come from the academy together. And then I think that's got us here in the end.
And to do it as a group with lads that have come through the academy, does that make it that bit more special?
Yeah, I mean, the likes of me, Murph and AJ, we've grown up together. We're all local lads and we know how much it means to the club.
Nick, final question to you. The club's made a habit of producing fantastic young players and then moving them on to bring in important money. What's next for you?
I just want to enjoy the night with the boys and we're celebrating my futures, whatever it is. I'm not looking forward to it. I'm not concentrating on it. I'm looking forward to the celebrations now with the boys.
Well done today. You're the empower man of the match. Ashley, do the honours.
I think his goal was a little more cultured than he would suggest. I just whacked it, he said, but the first touch was quite something. Grant McCann, Neil Lennon, Peter Bigree alongside me. Neil, I guess when we look back at this final, it all came down to who took their chances the better.
Yeah, I mean, Cheltenham did have their chances, but Crewe had that little bit of extra quality at the top end of the pitch. And what I liked about Crewe today was, you know, no matter what Cheltenham threw at them, they kept playing the same way. They played with great belief, and as Steve mentioned, they've got a great mentality, which obviously comes from winning football games, and what a run they've been on, and they played brilliantly second half as well.
Let's have a chat with the captain, David Artell. Here's with Patrick Davison.
Dave, a special day to the club. Just what does it mean to you?
Oh, it's fantastic. We've got, you know, 15,000 fans. We've had 19 games unbeaten. We've had people along the way. We've lost people. His kit man died last year. It's fantastic.
What's it like playing with these kids, especially the way they started the game, leading them, showing the lack of fear they play with?
They've done that for 19 games. And it's working our advantage. Everyone's sort of said, the kids, they're going to crumble. They don't know how special this is. That's the fact of the matter. And they've showed today, especially in the first 25 minutes, how good they are. Paoli's goal was the greatest in his stadium. And we set a stall out. We had to hang on at times. But we've developed that over the last sort of 6 months. And, you know, like, there's a lot of the young boys there, 17 just out of school, but they're men. It's as simple as that.
Very well done, Dave. Enjoy the celebrations.
Cheers, thanks very much.
And those celebrations will go long into the night as Crewe celebrate returning to League One. Pity we just heard from Neil there. It was ultimately down today to composure in front of the goal, wasn't it?
That's right, yeah. And, you know, these youngsters are fearless and they back themselves. We knew they had the ability, but I think is the Crewe ways, is that they're good human beings as well, very relaxed. When you saw them warming up, the smiles on their faces, they enjoyed the football. They weren't perturbed in the stadium at all. And we saw the difference that Steve Davis has made, the strength and resolve, putting your body on the line, the roles and responsibility, Westwood getting back on the line and knocking off. They know how to win, as well as being very, very good footballers. And, you wouldn't have thought that Artell and Phillips were the two oldest out there with the maturity of the performances. It was brilliant.
Grant, you were on the pitch at Old Trafford last season, celebrating your victory against Huddersfield for Peterborough. What are the conversations that happen between players at this point?
They just can't wait to get up there and lift the trophy, really. You know, it's going to be a great occasion for them, especially for the skipper there, David Artell. So, you know, I thought Crewe maybe just edged it in the end. A little bit disappointed for Cheltenham, obviously, but, you know, I thought Crewe looked really solid second half, and the two midfielders got on the ball a lot, Westwood and Murphy, and, you know, they looked solid.
Time to celebrate. Time to lift the trophy. Let's rejoin Andy Hinchcliffe and Bill Leslie.
And all these Crewe Alexandra players will remember this date, Sunday, May the 27th, the date of their final push, the latest in a series of standout moments this season. We look back to November the 5th, that was the date they decided it was time for Dario Gradi to move upstairs. 5 days later, Steve Davis became the manager. They lost the first game, cup tie against Colchester, just 4 defeats in 32 since. And this astonishing club record, now 19-game unbeaten run. It is a momentum that has carried them all the way. It has carried them to a treble against Cheltenham. It has carried them to the third tier. Mostly young, mostly homegrown, but with a little bit of experience in there as well. David Artell, the Crewe captain, leading the way up the steps. The experienced head that marshals this young band of brothers, which fulfills dreams and expectations, as we've heard already. Most of them hometown boys, pretty much all of them, 9 of the 11 in the starting 11, all coming through. And it makes moments like this, Andy, all that little more special.
It's just an absolutely extraordinary story. You said to these players 19 games ago, you'd be climbing the Wembley steps, you'd have just won the playoff final. They wouldn't have believed you. The club is run on the right level. They know exactly what type of football they want to play, and they believe in their young players, and that's why who were climbing the stairs to pick up that trophy.
Yeah, well, their climb, and last time that they came out of this league back in 1994, it led to a pretty extended stay in the Championship. Obviously, the questions as to how many of this group will stay together will dictate how far they will go, but this a moment to savour. Hard work, dedication, extra hours put in. A band of brothers that came through the academy together, and now together they climb into League One.
best part of 15,000 Crewe Alexandra fans celebrate. The man who has shaped the club celebrates, Dario Gradi, who's been in charge there since the early 80s. Mr. Crewe, he shaped the philosophy. He's provided the framework through which players and talented youth can flourish, including Steve Davis, a former player there himself. And there'll be few prouder here than Dario Gradi himself.
Absolutely. League One better watch out as well, because this Crewe side, if they do manage to keep all these young players together, they won't change their philosophy. They will really entertain next season.
Max Clayton, the 17-year-old who scored the goal to bring them to Wembley. So many wonderful stories within this wonderful runner. Word of sympathy, commiseration for Cheltenham at this point, who played their part in what was a pretty good final, given the conditions, given the stakes. They threw absolutely everything to try and keep their good run going, turn their four wins into five, but they fell a little short against a special moment from Nick Powell and against a late blow that it was always going to be hard to recover from. He's just about old enough to drink, AJ Leach-Smith, but you sense they'll all enjoy themselves tonight. Club that feels it belongs on a higher stage. Most of the last couple of decades it has been on a higher stage. Difficult times after relegation 3 years ago, and they actually came down with Cheltenham. But here they are, rising again. Steve Davis, who came in November, and on this wonderful sunny day in May, he's seen his young charges fulfil the ambitions. We'll have plenty more reaction from here at Wembley in a few moments' time. But Crewe Alexandra celebrate their return to League One.
In the beautiful sunshine at Wembley, Crewe are celebrating a beautiful moment in their history. They are returning to League One after a 2-0 win against Cheltenham, for whom it is a very tough and bitter pill to swallow. A missed opportunity here, a missed opportunity over the last few weeks. A gutting moment for the players, so too their manager, Mark Yates. And we can hear from him now. He's alongside Greg Whelan.
Mark, commiserations. In view of the way you play today, how difficult is this to take just at the moment?
Yeah, I'm proud of my players, immensely proud. I've been proud of them all season. They've produced. We had a nervous start for 10 or 15. A wonder strike from, you know, a prodigious talent. And then it was just chances, and he didn't come. But we don't blame people for missing chances at our club. And then we got caught, you know, trying to chase the game. And, you know, they're a good side, we know that. Good luck to them, well done to Steve and his players. But we go again.
Have you had the chance to speak to any of your players on the pitch? What have you been able to say to them so far?
Not a lot, just we have to make sure we win it next year rather than, you know, set the chance of coming here. So I'm really proud of them, really pleased with the effort they put in today. You know, we started, I said, a little bit sloppy, but I think we can be, we're giving the town something to shout about.
When your players get over the disappointment, what can they take from this season into next?
How good we've been, how hard we've worked, the standards we've set, and we have to push on now. We have to really push on. It's going to be tough. Got a few players out of contract that we've got to sort out, but my aim is to take the club forward and keep the better players and bring in one or two just to keep livening us up.
You started the season as one of the favourites for relegation, so does this turn out to be a season you can build on?
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. You know, it's been a good season. We've had a cup run. The chairman's happy. He's made a, you know, we've made a profit, which is how we try to work. We just get a competitive budget. You know, we've already got targets for next year, and we're going to go again.
Mark, commiserations today.
Pleasure. Thank you.
And Grant, once the dust has settled on what's happened today and the disappointment has begun to fade away, how should this season be viewed by Cheltenham?
I think they've got to look at it in a positive manner, to be honest. You know, they've, like you say, they were favourites for relegation at the start of the season. Mark Yates, is, you know, he's backed his players all the way. They started really well to the season. They slipped off a little bit, but they've come back again, and they were unlucky today. They had so many chances, and another day they could have won the game.
Adam Dugdale and Kelvin Mehta, two victorious Crewe players, are speaking with Patrick Davidson.
Adam, Kelvin, many congratulations. Is this feeling right now everything you dreamed it would be?
Yeah, and more, to be honest with you. You know, as I said to you last week,
someone said to you that the best way to go up is go to the playoffs, and there certainly is some good feeling, and everyone to 11 and the lads who come on and all the staff and the lads on the bench, they fully deserve it, and we're absolutely buzzing, and I can't put into words how we feel. We're absolutely chuffed.
Kelvin, only your 9th start as a professional footballer. Can you quite believe what's happening to you?
I can't, to be honest with you. It's come so quick. I've really, really enjoyed it. Wembley, it's every player's dream.
You're such a young group of players. Why do you think you started the games so fast? There didn't seem to be any fear there.
Well, the manager told us there was no fear. It's just like any other game. Every game's a cup final to us. We've shown that over the last 19 games now. We've won every one today by... Just the players battled and just played well, and we won.
And Adam, was this a moment that you thought would never come for you? You were released by the club as a youngster, had to battle your way back from non-league.
Yeah, but as I said to you, I've always believed. I always know I need that chance, and lucky enough, I've taken it. But I've got to give the big thanks to Steve, the gaffer, Neil Baker, Daddy O'Grady for first bringing me back to the club. And I'm repaying them now because, you know, what we set out from the start of the season to get promoted, that's what we've done, and I'm thrilled.
Well done, boys. Crewe have got some new heroes.
Thank you very much.
It's been great to see the manager, Steve Davis, just walking around the stadium and taking the applause from the fans. And Neil, you look at the job he's done. He took over November the 10th. They were down in 18th. He's just taken them to League One. That is some effort.
That's fantastic. And all credit to him. You know, couldn't have been easy coming in at that stage. And when you're following someone like Dario Grady, who's been a stalwart at the club and done some great things for the club, it's a difficult act to follow. But I'm very impressed with how Steve comes across. He seems very level-headed. Very methodical student of the game, and you can see that with the way his team plays.
What did he bring, Peter, when he arrived that was different?
I think a little bit of peace and tranquility. You know, he's quite an unassuming character, but he gave them belief. You know, it wasn't a fact that we were in 18th position on 19 points. It was a fact, right, the season starts from now. If we're going to progress, this is what we need to do. We need to be number one, harder to beat. Have no worries with you on the football, with the football at your feet. We know you can pass and we know you can go forward and score goals, but we need to have a strength and resolve in this division. He's imparted his knowledge on them. He's imparted his way of playing on them as well, and this is it coming to fruition now. Fantastic times, and when you think he is replacing a legend in Dario Grady, who is Crewe, it's amazing.
Now, when that goal in from Nick Powell went in, Neil, you were sat just outside the studio. I saw you on your phone immediately after it went in. Was that a quick call to the chairman? Because this is a player in real demand, isn't it?
Oh, it's wonderful. I really enjoyed watching him play today. Every time he picked the ball up, and you know, he found himself in good positions in between the lines. And when he drove with the ball, he's very elegant, very fluid mover with the ball. And his goal was just magnificent, but he was always a threat. Looks like he's enjoying himself.
He's not a bad wrestler either.
But, you know, even seeing him being interviewed, you know what it means to these kids who have come through the academy. The club means so much to them. And if he does go, then, you know, some team's going to get a hell of a talent there.
Grant, he said in the interview afterwards, he just whacked it. In truth, it was an awful lot better than that.
He hasn't whacked it. I think he was just a bit camera shy there. You know, it was a great touch. Just to, you know, the ball's come into him here, and you'll see it's just straight in. His left foot touch takes it inside. Bang.
Just describe how difficult a skill that is, that first touch that sets it up.
I think he's like giving me eyes. You see the Cheltenham players going one way, I think they're going, he's pulled it back. It's just it's an incredible strike.
And Peter, what do they do as a club here? Because you mentioned the scouts beforehand. We know that Manchester United are a club that are interested. Mm-hmm. Might someone come in, buy him, mm-hmm. and then keep him at Crewe for, say, another couple of seasons?
Absolutely. That's a perfect case scenario from Crewe. They're getting the financial gains, but they're keeping a player who they've educated. You know, they've spent an enormous amount of time with him to get him to the situation he is now. And it would be a great environment for him to flourish another division up, test himself again. Perfect case scenario for me.
Did Byron Moore's second goal that sealed it in the end sum up Crewe today in that even when they're under pressure, Neil, they remain patient?
Yeah, I was really impressed with Westwood today. He knows how to play midfield, that boy. And, you know, he got stronger as the game went on, the Byron. You know, patient, Leeds Smith sets him up lovely, and it's a really good finish. And they were patient all day. They just picked Cheltenham off at the right times, and the longer the second half went on, Crewe looked more likely to score again. He was excellent as well. Leeds Smith,
he was brilliant.
Terrific.
You know, the maturity in it, and as that move was in its infancy, he actually got the ball sort of 30 yards in his own half, and instead of running on and being the one up front that's going to get on the end of a cross, he waited and waited, didn't mark himself, and then ended up passing it to Byron Moore, who finished with aplomb. brilliant scenes. And the maturity that the Crewe side, with the average age, like we said, that played with, were amazing.
I mean, Mark Yates, Grant said that they're not going to talk about, they're going to reflect on those missed opportunities. But I guess, in truth, the players will, from a Cheltenham perspective. They did have some terrific opportunities.
They did, you know, and in a big game like this, you got to take one or two of them. They'll probably be kicked, but Yates, he says no one has a go at anyone about the chances, but I'm sure the players will have a go themselves.
They'll know, won't they?
Yeah, they'll know themselves, and it's, you know, it's all about bouncing back, like Mark says, and hopefully they do that.
Was it the occasion, Neil, that perhaps got the better of them in those crucial areas?
Possibly, just that lack of composure, you know. It's not, I mean, this is unlucky. He's done everything right. Yeah. That's just brilliant defending. And again, he does everything right here, Mohamed. You know, he sets it up, gets away. I just think it's a brilliant save from the keeper. Yeah. You know, it's on his left foot. He's done everything right. I just think that was the pivotal moment of the game where maybe, you know, it just popped Cheltenham's balloon on that occasion.
Agreed.
Oh, totally. That was when the game changed. That was their main opportunity to score. And what we didn't see there is his footwork. You know, as soon as Kyde moves the ball past the defender, he's advanced 5 yards, so he's cut the angle down. Brilliant from your most experienced player. Absolutely fantastic. We said there'll be important moments for the likes of him and Artel. And they were leaders with the young guys. They were taking everything on board. Great performance. I think when you lose at Wembley, you know, if you haven't played well, then that really, really sits with you. And Cheltenham can be really proud of where they play. They had a go, they didn't give up, created chances, just that little bit of quality in the final third.
And Neil, as Crewe begin to look forward to next season, if they can keep hold of some of their key players, which is going to be tough, how well will they fare next season?
I think they'll be fine. You know, I think the most important thing is the continuity that they keep. And if they get money for Powell, then they'll reinvest it in the club and they make find a couple more good players just to add to the squad. But I think the key word today was maturity. I mean, for some of those players to play so young in a big environment like this, they handle the occasion brilliantly.
Just a final word on your old club. Mark Yates says they will go again. You confident they can?
I think they will, yeah. Like I said, hopefully they can keep their players. You know, there's been talk about Marlon Pack and boys like that going. If they can keep them together, then I can see them being up there again next season, definitely.
Grant, Neil, Peter, thanks ever so much for your company this afternoon. So, the Football League season is done and dusted. It will all get underway in just 83 days' time. And when it finally does return, Crewe Alexandra will be a League One club once again. Have a great summer. We'll see you soon.